Hi, this is Mindy Lighthype, and today I would like to go through the list of supplies that I use for my regular drawing classes. I find that when I go into an art store or I go online to shop, there's just a huge variety of things to choose from, and it can be very confusing, especially for the beginner. So many supplies can be on sale, on clearance, or they can be very expensive, and you don't really know what you're doing when you first start out, and so I find that by going through the supplies that I recommend, it is very beneficial. It gives you a starting education of what to use, when, and how. That's part of the learning curve of being introduced to the materials that you'll be using. The materials that I recommend are not overly expensive. They're a good medium quality. One of the mistakes that I find that beginners usually make is that they buy inexpensive supplies. The reasoning behind this is not just cost. It is because they just feel that, well, I'll buy more expensive things when I get better. But one of the things that you need to understand as a beginning artist is that you can struggle with the supplies by buying things that are of low caliber or lesser quality. You may actually be making the joy of drawing more difficult because the supplies that you're using are fighting you. You're battling with your supplies and you can get very discouraged. This short video will give you an introduction to the tools of drawing that I believe are the best bang for your buck. The money that you spend will be well worth it and it will make your drawing easier. There are many art supplies available and I want to make sure that you start off on the right foot. So here we go. Let's take a look at the supplies. For this series of exercises, it is best if you use the Strathmore drawing paper. It's very important that the cover says drawing. Strathmore has a series of papers that looks very similar, but the word may say sketch here, and that's not the paper that you want. You absolutely want to have the drawing paper. This particular paper is a 400 series. Strathmore comes in, I believe, three different series. There's a 300, a 400, and a 500 series. 300 paper series is considered student grade, and it's used in school systems, and is relatively inexpensive, and the paper quality is not great. It's mostly made for disposable art. 400 series is a good artist paper. It's a good all-around paper, and it can be found in a variety of stores, from office supply stores to Michael's or art and craft stores like Joann's, and it also can be found very easily on the internet. Strathmore also comes in a 500 series, and that's their professional grade. That is the highest professional quality 100% cotton rag paper that you can purchase, and it's relatively expensive in comparison to the 400 series. I'd like for you to use the Strathmore drawing paper 400 series. It comes in a premium recycled, which is what you see here, and it also comes in a what's called just a drawing medium. They may have different covers to it now. The recycled is usually going to show you green because it's recycled paper. Part of it is recycled. And the brown cover will be non-recycled paper. But the main difference is actually the color that you'll be seeing of the paper. It's a subtle difference, but the recycled paper has been bleached. So the paper tends to be a brighter white, whereas the regular paper is more of a cream. It doesn't matter to me which one you use. I actually prefer the white because I like the contrast. If you like to have a paper that's more of a beige or a cream color, then you want to go with their regular drawing paper. If you choose to have something that's a little brighter white, then you want to go with the recycled paper. One of the things that you'll also learn is that the paper itself is a medium tooth. The word tooth basically means the texture of the paper, the surface of the paper. And so you want a medium surface. You also want a paper that's going to be acid-free. You don't want your drawings to fall apart. If you've ever read a newspaper or had a newspaper around for any length of time, you'll find that it will start to turn yellow very easily. That's the acids that is leaching out of the paper and causing it to break down, just as it would be in a tree. But through modern processes, they're able to remove that acid from the paper so that it does not break down. And I find that that's an excellent thing to have. I also recommend a plastic eraser, and you can buy this in any office supply store. Here I'm using a Pentel Click Eraser, but it also comes in many different varieties and shapes. You can also have it in a stick form, which is wider. They're both good to have. I prefer the Pentel Click Eraser opposed to the stick eraser, as it allows me to get into smaller and tighter areas. And then there's also the Pink Pearl Eraser, which I don't usually recommend. It's been around for a very long time, and it's the eraser that you find on the end of your pencils that you write with in grade school. And it tends to be very abrasive. And a lot of times it can actually rip up or tear the surface of your paper. The plastic erasers were actually made to work on plastics, on mylars and different kinds of films, because they're softer. So I sort of look at the Pink Pearl as an Ajax or a Comet, kind of an abrasive. You wouldn't necessarily want to use a Comet on a surface like that would be porcelain or something like that. And this would be more like soft scrub. So, you know, depending on what you're going to be using it for, if you have to make a choice, I would go with the plastic erasers because they're a little bit more gentle. Then you also have the kneaded eraser. And here I only have half of a kneaded eraser. But one of the things that I really want you to do, we're going to be using a lot of this as a tool. The kneaded eraser is probably, hands down, my favorite eraser. When it comes out of the package, it's a sort of a pale gray, and it's very important that you begin to knead it. And what I mean, I always tell my students that you need to knead your kneaded eraser. And it's one of the most important things that you'll hear me talk about. It's sort of like a taffy pull, okay? And the more you knead it, the softer and more pliable it will become, and it will actually be much better to use. One of the things I really hate to see is when students come into my class and their kneaded eraser is black and hard and you can't pull it at all. It's not going to do anything for you at that point. So it's really a waste. You've kind of ruined the kneaded eraser. But if you take good care of the eraser and you knead it a lot, it actually will work for quite some time. And then also, I've gotten a series of pencils out. And normally, there are so many different manufacturers that are out there. And I have found that I particularly like Tombow, which is a Japanese pencil. You can go through, if you have pencils already, you can go through and look and see at the end of your pencil, it would have a number. And one of the things that you want to have is a variety of pencils. Here's an ebony pencil, and this is probably the darkest pencil that is made. It's the softest lead, and it's the darkest lead. And I use that occasionally. And you want to think of the pencil range as being HB, which is right in the middle. So what will happen is that the HB pencil is the pencil that is in the center. This is like a pH scale. When the numbers go up this way, they'll go 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and they'll go all the way to 9. And then they will have an H after them. The higher the number, the harder the lead, which means the finer the point, and actually the lighter the mark it will make. And we're gonna learn a lot about that. The next thing is that as it goes this way up the scale, it'll go from HB all the way up to 9B, and I believe that ebony is sort of like a 10B. The B actually represents soft, And the higher the number, the softer the lead, and the darker the marks and the wider the marks will be made. And so, as I said, we're going to be experimenting with different types of pencils. I do have a recommended sheet of supplies that you can work from. But if you have things at home, you might want to try them out and just see how they work. Another supply that comes in really handy when doing these exercises and later on in the process of your work is what's called an eraser shield. The eraser shield is just a little, you can barely see it when I turn it on its edge. It's an extremely thin piece of metal that is flexible, and it has little templates in it. It's usually found, I've purchased mine in an office supply store, but you can find it in architectural drawing supplies, or I believe you can also find it on a regular online in the art supplies. It's called an eraser shield or an eraser guard. This particular manufacturer's name is Alvin, and it will be in the list of supplies. You also might want to have some kind of a brush. This is an old watercolor brush, and the handle fell off of it. So I'm able to use this to dust off my paper. You can use a paper towel. You can use any kind. You can use a feather, whatever you would like. But it's better that you get into the habit of brushing away debris opposed to blowing onto the paper. When I found that when I blow onto the paper, a lot of times you could get little particles of condensation that are, lack of a better word, spit on your drawing. And you certainly don't want to do that, because when you go to move it with your hand, or even sometimes when you do press it with your hand, you press too hard and you smear anything that would be there. The other thing that I also recommend is repositionable tape. This is an artist tape that's a very low tack, and you can press it down onto things and then very easily lift it up. It has enough tack that it sticks, but it also has enough that it lifts up without taking the paper with it. So it may look like masking tape. It is not masking tape. It is called artist tape. And again, you can get this online or any of the art supply stores. It also, you know, as I said, do not use masking tape, and also do not use blue tape that you, painter's tape that you use, that you would get from Home Depot, because the tack is too heavy, and when you go to remove it off of your paper, you will rip the paper and you'll be very unhappy later on. The next item on the list is tracing paper. Tracing paper is one of the most invaluable tools that I use for a variety of reasons. I use tracing paper to protect my drawings, to correct my mistakes. I use tracing paper as a barrier between my hand and the piece that I'm working on to keep it clean. I use tracing paper for composition. There are two ways that you can go in purchasing your tracing paper. Regular tracing paper is a very thin, semi-transparent paper, very similar to tissue paper. It's fairly thin, it crinkles, and it tears easily. A pad of regular tracing paper can cost under $5 and can be found online in art and craft supply stores as well as office supply stores. My tracing paper of choice is tracing vellum. It's a much heavier weight tracing paper. It's archival, meaning that it's acid-free, so it will not yellow, it does not tear as easily, and I use it to archive my drawings for future reference and use. A pad of tracing vellum can cost anywhere from $20 to $25. So you can see that the difference in price is substantial if you're going to go with tracing vellum. Either way, it's a valuable tool, and I will leave it up to you as to which you prefer, considering your budget.
To aid in blending your graphite, a great tool is a paper stump. A fancy word for a paper stump is a tortillon. Basically, all it is a piece of paper that's rolled up that comes to a point. There are two kinds. This particular one is hollow on the end, and it's disposable. Once you use it, there's no way that you can clean it up. Here's one that's been used, and you can see that the tip is not as pointed. They're less expensive than the other kind that are solid. Here are two different sizes that are solid, and basically what happens is that, again, this is paper and it's rolled very tightly, and it works very much like as if it was a pencil. These can be sharpened, or you can use sandpaper to clean off the edge. Here's the kind of sandpaper that you can use to resharpen the point on the paper stump. So basically what I'm doing is I'm using my thumb to rotate it. And it's on an angle so that it creates a point. A lot of people also use these kinds of little sandpaper to do their pencils. I don't prefer to do that because I find it too time consuming and messy. But you can use this also if you want to. This is a graphite stick. And the graphite stick is what you have in your pencils, only it's in a stick form. And it comes in the different softness and hardness of leads. You can use this to do broad areas of tone, opposed to using the point. It adds for a much faster coverage and possibly an even a more even coverage, as the surface that you're working on is quite wide.
Another great addition to this supply list is a piece of 8x10 clear plexiglass that is approximately 1/8 of an inch thick. Along with the plexiglass, you will need a black marker to draw on the surface of the plexiglass. I recommend the Vis-a-Vis marker. This marker easily erases from the surface of the plexiglass so that you can use it again and again. All you need is a damp cloth and it will come off immediately. Do not purchase a permanent marker. Any marks that you make on the plexiglass will remain permanent and you will not be able to remove them or use the plexiglass again. The last item on my list is a pencil sharpener. You will hear me in future lessons talking about sharpening the pencil. It is very important to have a good pencil sharpener, and unfortunately, good pencil sharpeners are either extremely expensive or difficult to find. I recently found a wonderful pencil sharpener that is manual that will take a variety of circumferences of lead on Amazon.com. The cost was under $10, which included shipping. This is a great, lightweight, portable pencil sharpener, and I highly recommend this pencil sharpener over the little handheld pencil sharpeners. They never really get a very good point, and the electric pencil sharpeners are not easy to transport. This pencil sharpener does not require batteries, just the use of your hand, and it does come with a clamp that you can attach it to a table. Whatever you do, find yourself a pencil sharpener that's going to give you a good point. This will be invaluable to your drawing success. This is the end of the introduction to the art supplies used in graphite drawing. I hope that you have found this informative. Please make sure that you download the PDF with the list of supplies and the links of where you can get it online. This is Mindy Lighthype. You can see more of my tutorials at www.mindylighthype.com.